I welcome you all in this lunch, after lunch session. So we have with us Dr. Anand Bulushu from IIT Roorkee. I welcome him in our institute, and I'm really thankful to him. He took all the pain to come over here from IIT Roorkee to NIT Patiala Chandigarh, and straight away he is with us for his talk without even a break of 2 minutes. So I'm not going to take much time, just a brief introduction about Dr. Anand Bulushu. Dr. Anand Bulushu is presently working in Electronics and Communication Engineering Department of IIT Roorkee. He also worked as Senior Research Engineer with IIT Bombay and as Senior Design Engineer with Freescale Semiconductor India. Mr. Bulushu has done his doctoral in Microelectronics from IIT Bombay. He is handling DST projects related to nanoscale VLSI circuit designs. He is member of IEEE Circuits and Systems Society, Electron Device Society and Solid State Circuits Society. His areas of interest are circuit design, variation aware VLSI circuit design methodology, delay methods, delay and timing models for VLSI circuits, VLSI devices, novel device circuit co-design methodologies. He has number of publications in IEEE Transactions and other reputed journals. So without taking much time, and I don't want to stand in between you and Dr. Anand Bulushu, so I invite him for his talk on nanoscale VLSI design. So Dr. Anand Bulushu, please.
Here is the talk. The talk is, I'll have to.
This
one. Oh, I've got it. Take it. I'll do. Put it in full screen mode. F5. Is there a keyboard to this?
Yes.
Okay. This keyboard is. Okay. Okay. So I am Anand Bulushu from IIT Roorkee. Today, what I'll talk about nanoscale VLSI circuit design. That is, how is it different from the normal circuit design? So what are the issues, and what do we need to what care do we need to take? So what is the background? What is the background material preparation that we need to do? So I'll start from the background material, and then I'll get into a solution of one problem, that one or two problems that we encounter in nanoscale circuit design on which we are working. So this in this area, three PhD students of mine have worked. One has submitted, one has completed the degree recently. The other one has submitted her thesis, and the third one is continuing work. So I work in two areas. One is this area. The other one is in device circuit interaction. That is transistors. How the transistor phenomenon, or novel transistors, can be used in circuit design. So in this area, this is our team. So that's why I'm writing all the names, right? So first thing we'll discuss is what are the I'll concentrate on timing, delays, etc. I'll not go into power considerations of circuit design. And so what are the timing issues, timing related issues in VLSI circuit design? We'll first discuss this, then we'll discuss a background material. I'll cover a background material, which is, see, nanoscale circuit design needs some methodical approach. So method of logical effort is an effort, it is a method for systematic circuit design. So I'll discuss that method. Then I'll discuss how several issues related to nanoscale technologies are handled in circuit design at circuit design level in our group. So why do we, so in nanoscale circuit design or in any VLSI circuit design, you require automation. Why do you require automation? Because of the sheer number of transistors that you can see here. So the sheer number of, that number of transistors is so high, number of logic gates is so high that you cannot go without automation. So so what do? You have standard cells. Standard cells are already designed, pre-designed with complete layout and characterization, that is their timing and power characteristics are all well characterized in the sense with respect to some parameters. And so these standard cells are the basic like macros in program or subprograms in a program, and they are integrated into the circuit, which is through some CAD tools. So that is how the VLSI circuit design, digital VLSI circuit design happens. A part of digital VLSI circuit design is also like what an electrical engineer does, designing the entire circuit. That is also there. That is called full custom design, but that's only a minor part of digital VLSI circuit design flow. Mostly it is done through CAD tools, automation, and standard cells are well designed earlier. And these standard cells are then integrated into the circuit. As you can see, this is a, here I have kept layout of a huge circuit, which is Intel's chip. So layout, this is a picture taken from the top, okay, after the packaging is removed, okay. So you require, so if it is CAD tool based, you require some systematic methods, some formal mathematically, some formal methods. It's not entirely formal, but you require some systematic methods through which you can code into a tool and which would allow you to do circuit design, isn't it? So there is and the basic one of the major issues in circuit design is sizing the transistor. You know, the MOS, these transistors are MOSFETs which are used in VLSI circuits. So the MOSFETs have you have the freedom to choose their size, widths especially. Lengths are kept at minimum. The MOSFET channel length is kept at its minimum value for digital circuits, but the width, you have a choice to vary the width. So how do you vary the width? How do you vary the width in such a manner that you get minimum delays? That is a problem, classical problem in VLSI circuits, and it has been handled for some 40 years. And when you come to nanoscale technologies, CMOS technologies, then the problem assumes some new color. That's the only issue. Otherwise, the problem is quite old. Okay. So what is the major, issue at nanoscale technologies? See, earlier, this I am talking because there might be several of us with varied background. That's why I am getting into the topic somewhat slowly. Yeah. There could have been earlier what one needs to do essentially is get a relationship between the sizes of transistors and the delay and timing parameters of a logic gate. That is the first thing one needs to do. Once that is there, then you can go ahead with circuit design, isn't it? So that is the basic information which is needed, or basic relationship which is needed. So when you want to do that, you first need to get the IV relationship. That is, what are the terminal voltages of transistors and what are the current values. But as you go into nano regime, the IV relationships become quite complicated, and the relationships which you derive in this manner become very complex and unusable. So logical effort, method of logical effort is an was the first and till now I think the most popular method to handle this issue. So that we are now going to first derive the basic delay model used in method of logical effort. It's a popular method, And it is, I think, the most popular method today in designing digital VLSI circuits. And also, it is at the heart of several CAD tools like timing optimizer. There is something called timing optimizer. So at the heart of that, you have, again, this method of logical effort working. So with some other name, gain balancing, load balancing, there are some such names which are given to it, but it is essentially the method of logical effort which works there. So first we will derive the basic delay model which is used in method of logical effort. It looks very simple, and its derivation usually in textbooks is done in a manner using some RC equivalent of transistors, but I don't feel that is elegant, because that way you are again giving an equivalent circuit to the transistor, which you don't want to. You want a very generic derivation, because this method and the basic delay model underlying the method, both of them work for all kinds of technologies. They work even for novel transistors. So what might be the reason? So the reason is that they are valid from a very basic fundamental due to a fundamental reason, and we'll derive the delay model using that fundamental reasoning. And after that, I'll explain the method. Then I'll explain how one of the issues that you encounter in nanoscale VLSI circuits that we have tried to solve, our group has, how we have tried to solve that. Okay. So first part is kind of tutorial part, where we prepare a background. And the second part is more current issues. Kind of part. So let us see how much we are able to cover today. Okay. So I'll now use board for a little while, because derive something using slides is quite atrocious to the audience also. You might have seen this CMOS inverter circuit diagram several times. So now you have an input, okay? Input voltage 0 to VDD, and let us first assume it to be a RAM, ideal RAM. And then you have an output voltage, which is, this is the power supply. The output voltage which falls from VDD supply voltage to 0. So now we want to get a relationship for delay with respect to the size of inverter. How do you define the size of inverter? Lengths are at the minimum channel length possible. The size is, there is a specific relationship WP by WL that is used in a given standard cell library in a technology. Suppose it is 2. Because you want to balance the rise and fall delays, you want to keep them, suppose you want to keep them equal, then you have to maintain a specific ratio. These days in 45 nanometer CMOS technology or so, it is around 1.2, but earlier it was 2. So let's keep using that 2 for illustration purpose. So now once I have defined the value of WN, the size of the inverter is defined, because WP by WN is fixed. This is the PMOS and this is the NMOS. Okay. So first thing that we will, as I have written in the, I mean, I'll use the slides and board simultaneously for this part. The first thing that, let us first assume that there is a, let's first get to know that there is a parasitic capacitance associated with the output node. Okay, and this is the output load capacitance. Why do we write capacitance, show only capacitances and not resistances? Because this is MOS circuits, and in MOS circuit, MOSFET, especially at frequencies in which we are interested, would not have a capacitive reactance, isn't it? It's just acting as a capacitance, and the capacitance and the input gate resistance is almost negligible. I mean, or quite high, isn't it? The MOSFET gate only offers a capacitance that you might be knowing, isn't it? So that's why the next, whatever next logic gate follows this inverter would be a MOSFET logic gate, and therefore it would offer only a capacitance and not a resistance, isn't it? So that's why we only talk about capacitances here. So first, let us assume that the input transition time, let us take this to be input transition time, starting here, and this is the input transition time. Let's first assume that this input transition time is proportional to output capacitance plus parasitic capacitance. First, let's assume this. So once we have assumed this, how does it proceed? Let us see. What is the value of output voltage at this point? At this point, the output voltage is VDD, because input was 0, the output would be at VDD. So, and as the input voltage rises, the output voltage starts falling. So that's what that you know that, isn't it? So now let us break this input ramp into small parts, incremental parts of delta V size each. Okay. So in this, in the first part, what is the input voltage, output voltage? It is VDD. So what is the drain to source voltage of this and this? These were fixed because this is 0, VDD minus V out, and this is V out minus 0. These two are now fixed. So drain voltages are at a certain value, and the gate voltage has a certain average value within that port, isn't it? So there is an average current through which it discharges, isn't it? So what would be the change in output voltage? The change in output voltage, delta V out, would be the average current, integral of average current, or average current into this average current in this particular average current associated with this incremental voltage, okay, and integrating it over this time, let us call this delta t, or multiplying it with delta t, okay, because let's say small incremental change in voltage, and therefore the average current can just be multiplied by change in current, the time, isn't it, divided by the total capacitance at the output. So this is for the first step. Let us say a kth step. So what happens at kth step? Delta V out A, you would find that it is I average. Again, you take an average current associated with that step into again the same delta T, because divided by C out plus C T. So if the initial output voltage was V out K minus 1 here, and it reaches V out K, which is V out, the output is falling, isn't it? V out K minus 1 minus delta V K, isn't it? Then, so we reach from V out, the output voltage reaches from V out K minus 1 to V out K, which is, and the delta V out is given by this, isn't it? So, what would now, if I increase the input transition time by a factor alpha, suppose, if I increase the input transition, now you just keep these two points in mind, and if I increase the input transition time by a factor alpha, and therefore all these delta t's will increase by a factor alpha, because we are keeping the same number of incremental delta this, okay?
So, and we have first taken this point that we are saying that the input transition time and total output capacitance will be having a constant ratio. That is, how do you manage that? You, when you increase the input transition time, you increase output capacitance in such a manner that these two have a constant ratio. So what would happen? So you would find that this increases by alpha times, isn't it? And this has increased, time has again increased by a factor alpha. Isn't it? This has increased by alpha times, this has increased by a factor alpha, this has also increased by a factor alpha. Isn't it? So now what the initial delta V1 is the same. So initially you had output voltage VDD, after this incremental change in voltage you had VDD minus delta V out 1, isn't it? So this VDD minus delta V out 1 again comes out to be the same. It's quite obvious, it should be like that. And likewise for the kth step, it again comes out to be the same, isn't it? So what we find is that if this is the input output voltage at this time, V out of time tr, this V out would remain constant. See for by induction, isn't it? By mathematical induction, you can see for any step the difference would be the same if you maintain this condition, and for the first step it would be the same if you maintain this condition. So it means that for any step, the difference in output or the output voltage value after that incremental increase in voltage, input voltage, should remain constant even when you increase input transition time while maintaining this relationship, isn't it? And it's quite, it's not counterintuitive, it's quite intuitively seen also. So V out of TR, the output transition time at when the input has risen to VDD, when the input has risen to power supply voltage, must remain constant. Okay. Likewise, now let us look at the other scenario. So when you maintain this relationship, essentially when you maintain this relationship and when you increase the output capacitance in input transition time in this manner, then V out of TR remains constant, and at each input voltage, there is a corresponding output voltage. There is a one-to-one relationship between input voltages and output voltages. Can you do this? Isn't it? Okay. So now let us look at the other scenario. What happens after the input has risen to VDD? is the same kind of one-to-one relationship again going to manifest? That's what we are going to see. And yes, it is going to manifest. Why? Now the input voltage V in is VDD. It is now fixed, isn't it? So what now happens, for each small change in output voltage, the average current is now a function of, see that, average current for each small section of the output voltage decrement, is that average current is now a function of what? V in, which is VDD, isn't it? And V out. Okay, it's a function of only these two. V in is fixed, so it's just a function of V out. Okay? So you can define an average current associated with each of these sections now. And what is the decrement V out in V out? It is from V out. In the first section, it is from V out of TR to V out of TR minus some delta V out, isn't it? Delta V out 1, that is for the first section, isn't it? I will not use much of word after this. This is the, I think, first and last or maybe major use of word. So, yeah. So, and after, for kth section again like this, so what would it be? What would this delta V out 1 be? Delta V out 1 would be, as earlier, it is again CL plus CP, C out plus CP into answer. I average into whatever was the, now again we are calling this time as delta t. It might get, it might be confusing here again. So let's call it delta t out. Okay. So delta t out, I average into this thing divided by t out plus c. So that's the decrement. For kth section, again it's similar, isn't it? Okay. So what happens? This is how it is. The output is falling. What happens if I increase c out and maintain this condition? That is, I have increased CR in also. So here I have increased C out. So what happens now? When I increase C out by alpha times, and if the same delta V out is to happen, I am looking at the same sections in the output voltage. If the same delta V out is to happen, delta T out has to increase by alpha times. There is no other way. Then delta T out has to increase by alpha times. Okay. So what is the, what do you mean by this? You are saying that if I maintain this condition and if I change output capacitance and input transition time, I'll have to change them simultaneously. Simultaneously while maintaining this condition, in that case, there will be if I increase the input transition time and output capacitance in such a manner that this condition is followed, then this entire thing expands by which I have increased the input transition time. Isn't it again expands? So what do I mean to say? I mean to say that if this is the relay, this is input and this is output. If this and 50%, if I am talking about 50% delay, there could be several definitions of delay. One of them is 50% delay. If I am talking about 50% delay, then here till here the time is fixed, or time increases by alpha times if I increase low output capacitance while maintaining this condition, then the time increases by alpha times from here till here, and from here till 50% again it increases by the same alpha times. Okay. So I am saying that the delay, if I maintain this condition, then delay is proportional to C out plus C V. It's quite intuitively seen also. Right? Now, let's move to this. So, if I plot the delay versus C out by C in here, how would it look like? See, the input, it would look like this. It would look like a proportional relationship starting from origin. This is, I mean, I can use TR in scale or I can use C out by CP scale, C out plus CP scale. So let's use C out by plus CP scale. So it's just a proportional relationship, isn't it? So if I just write, plot it across C out, how would it look like? There is an intercept now, because this point, this axis would move here. If I plot it across C out only, isn't it? Okay. So now there is an intercept, and you find it this way, isn't it? What if I increase, if I keep the C out value same, TR in value the same? But if I increase the size of the inverter, how do I increase the size of inverter? By increasing Wn and thereby Wp also.
So both I am increasing by beta times.
What would happen if I increase both of them by beta times? And I want to get the same delay. Suppose I want to get the, I have changed the output capacitance by a certain value and I want to get the same change in delay. Then or I want to see how much is the change in delay. So what would happen? In each of these, the current has now increased by beta times. Then, if the current has increased by beta times, delta T's would all shrink. Or in this part, you will find that the output change in output voltage would increase by beta times. Isn't? And in this part, you would see that delta T's would shrink by beta times. Or in other words, if C out by C in, C out plus CP is increased by beta times, then you get the same delay. If C out plus CP is increased by delta beta times, if I increase this size by beta times, and if I increase C out plus CP by beta times, then I get the same delay, isn't it? Or if there is a certain delta C out, and if I increase, in the earlier case, for a certain delta C out, if there was certain delta D, delta delay, increase in delay. Now, when I increase this by beta times, using the same arguments, I find that that delta C out also increases by beta times, isn't it? So what do I mean to say? I mean to say that the slope that I find here in this delay versus C out plot, that slope is proportional, inversely proportional to size of the inverter. That's what I mean to say, isn't it? And it's also intuitively seen why it might be so, isn't it? That is now inversely proportional. If you work out delta C out, what is it? It is just delta C out larger by beta times, you get the same change in delay. So slope is inversely proportional to beta. Isn't it right? So that's what. So if I can also plot it, the same information in another manner. I can say that I will plot C out by W. Then I get a unique line for all inverters, for inverters of any size. The slope is inversely proportional to beta. You can also say it in, you can also say the keep the same statement in another manner, saying that I, instead of plotting delay versus C out, I'll plot delay versus C out by W, that is C out by size. Okay, then I get a unique line for all the inverters. Don't you see that? Isn't? So what do I mean to say by this? So what is input capacitance of an inverter proportional to? It is proportional to W into L. So if I increase W by beta times, I have increased input capacitance by beta. Isn't? So therefore I can also write it as plot delay versus C out by C. Then this becomes dimensionless. It is comparable. So delay versus C out by C in unique straight line with a unique slope and for inverters of If you have done VLSI design course earlier, then you'll find it's easy to digest. I mean, easy to accept whatever I'm saying. Otherwise, it might look quite—it's quite intuitive. I think even otherwise, one might be able to accept what I'm saying. That's true. Okay. So this line actually characterizes a given CMOS technology. That is, in a given CMOS technology, if you fix WP by WN, you get a unique slope for an inverter, isn't it? Okay. What about other gates? For other gates also, whatever I said, this was quite generic. I was just saying that the current is function of this and this, that's all. I have not written an expression for current, isn't it? So for other gates also, these kind of arguments are valid. For example, if you look at a NAND gate, if you look at this NAND gate, and you will find that there are these two transistors in series. Suppose B is equal to VDD and A is switching from 0 to VDD. Then the current is because of A, and B is at a fixed voltage. So again, what are the terminals where the voltages are changing? A, input, and out. Here also the voltage would change, but that's again a function of this and this, isn't it? So external ports are only the output port and the input port, isn't it? So therefore it's just a function of V out and V in again. Again the same arguments run, okay? Even if I change the logic gate, okay? I'll have to, so that's why I'll again get a similar straight line characterizing a NAND gate. Okay, so how do I use this information? I'll say that slope G into D, delta at a time unit and G at a time unit. Okay, and G is equal to 1 for an inverter. This G I call logical. For NAND gate, I get some other slope. I can write it as G into delta. Delta is the same as that I have got from inverter. G is equal to how do you estimate that? Did you encounter this? I think it's useful for transistor sizing and accuracy in general. So, for example, you have this inverter with size 1, that is width is 1 unit here, and here the width is 2 units to balance output and rise and fall delays. In older technologies. Now I am saying it is around 1.2 or 1.1, this ratio, not 2. Okay. So for an NAND gate, what would happen? Again, for an NAND gate, you would say that both the inputs would be switching simultaneously. That kind of scenario would come very rarely. In general, one of the inputs would only switch. So suppose the input A is switching. Input A is switching from 0 to 1. And input B is at 1, that is VDD. Then to get the same kind of delay, suppose the load capacitance of inverter and this NAND gate are equal, kept equal. To get almost similar delays for both the cases, what would you do? You would size the N MOSFETs in the NAND gate, which are in series, with having double bit. You'll keep them at double bit. See, because they are in series, the current would almost be half. That is the simplistic argument that we are making. So you keep them at double bit, so you get almost the same current as the inverters and MOSFETs discharge. So if the output is getting discharged, this has certain current, you want the same current here, you just double the series transistors. So you get the same current discharging the output capacitance. Isn't? See, same value of output capacitance, you may get almost equal delay. Not equal, but you may get nearly somewhat equal delay. What about charging? So in charging also, suppose A is at VDD and B is switching from 0 to 1 to 0, then output will get charged, 1 to 0. So only one of the transistors is charging the output, and therefore it's like an inverter scenario. So for P MOSFET, you keep the same kind of ratio. For N MOSFET, you just double it. That is, if the transistors are in series, you double. If they are in parallel, keep them same as in the inverter, is it? So how would you now get the logical effort, I mean this G, value of G roughly? What is this value of G? Okay, so now what is the way we have seen the delay? So the delay, how have we written the delay? Now after all this arguments about how timing parameters vary, etc. We have written delay as G into delta into C out by C in plus P into delta. What is this? This is the slope and this is intercept. Is it? Whatever we had derived just now, some time back, that it was essentially this. This is what we had derived. Okay. So for suppose this is the inverter thing, and for a NAND gate, two input NAND gate, again you get the same kind of relationship. Delay is G into delta C out by C in. Okay. So I am looking at say certain delta delay, change in delay. Then this P into delta goes away, certain delta C out. For equal value of delta C out, so this G is 1 initially, I mean for inverter the G value of G is 1 by definition. For NAND gate we want to get the value of G. Then for equal change in delay, if I want to get equal change in delay, the output capacitance, change in output capacitance is equal. I have said that in this case, I have said if I size them this way, the delay for a given load capacitance would be equal for NAND gate and inverter. That is, for a given change in output capacitance, the delay would change in increase in delay would be equal for inverter and NAND gate. For if I size the inverter and NAND gate in this manner, then, but what is the input capacitance of the NAND gate compared to the inverter? So for inverter, it was 3 units. Just let us assume that input capacitance of MOSFETs is proportional to size. Okay, 2 plus 1, 3 units. Here it is, for one of the inputs it is 2 plus 2, 4 units, isn't it?
So for this, this was 3 units, and for this, this was 4 units. So it has increased by 4 by 3 times that of inverter, isn't it? See, if that the change in delay is equal as it is for this kind of sizing, then G9 must be 4 by 3. Okay? So that's why we say that logical effort G for a NAND gate is nearly 4 by 3. These are all back of envelope calculations. They may not be accurate, but they are quite near accurate. Okay? So logical effort of inverter is 1, that of NAND gate is 4 by 3. Likewise, we do some okay, time is going, so I will not discuss much about this. Likewise, we do some calculations for inverter followed by transmission gate, and we get its logical effort to be 2, okay, using similar arguments. So what is this method of logical effort? I'll just explain method of logical effort and stop it here. So till now we have discussed the how this delay model, which is at the heart of method of logical effort, is derived. And the second thing that we have discussed was how the logical effort of different logic gates can be roughly estimated. Okay. So now we'll discuss how this is useful in sizing transistors. So usually a logic circuit would be, for example, this is a buffer inverter chain. It would be a multi-stage circuit between one latch and the other latch. See, there are data paths between latches. Okay. In a VLSI circuit, okay. So, and in one clock cycle from one flip-flop to the other flip-flop, the data should move through the random logic, through a random logic, isn't it? And that timing is very essential. You must maintain that timing. It should not happen that the data arrives after the second latch has switched. I mean, then it is of no use. Second latch has taken a wrong data, isn't it? So you want that timing to be very well maintained. So for that, if when you pick up cells from standard cell library, you want the right cells to be picked up by the CAD tool. So the CAD tool has a method in written inside it. Or if you are designing a full custom circuit, that is you have the latches and you are yourself sizing all the transistors in the logic gates in that data path, then also you need a method to do that. So that method is method of logical effort, and that uses our simple delay model that we have seen just now. Okay? So what is the delay of this buffer here? It is delay of first inverter plus second plus nth, isn't it? Okay. So how can we write it using our simple delay model? We can write it as, suppose it was not a buffer, if it was a random logic circuit, we can write, for a buffer, all the G's would be 1, that's right. For a random logic circuit, it would be G1 into C out 2 by C out, C in 1, I mean C in 2 by C out 1 by C in 1. Now C out 1 is C in 2, isn't it? So C out 1 is C in 2 likewise, isn't it? So you can see that when you write it this way, we want to add plus all the parasitic delays, which are the intercepts, added up. Now, parasitic delays of all logic gates, you see, you cannot change them using whatever. It's a technology parameter. So, this is fixed. Second part is fixed. It's only this part which you can minimize. So, you need to minimize all these. But when you multiply all of them, what do you find? All the G's get multiplied. Suppose it's inverter followed by NAND gate followed by NOR gate, some inverter, something like that, isn't it? So then all the G's are fixed for all the logic gates, isn't it? Slopes are all fixed. They characterize a logic gate in a CMOS technology. So all the G's are fixed. So when you multiply, if suppose you multiply all these terms, you find that this is a fixed value, pi G, which is okay, and all the C out intermediate C outs or C ins get cancelled, and you get just C out by C in 1, isn't it? So what is this C out? C out is the load, final load capacitance that you need to drive. Suppose it's the input capacitance of a latch. okay, suppose, or it's an output capacitance kept outside an long interconnects capacitance, whatever it could be, okay. And what is the scene? Scene is the first inverter's capacitance. So what do you mean by this? You say that, see, I want to drive this large capacitance. It is externally given to me. It's an interconnects capacitance, and I want to the input capacitance of the driving circuit should not be larger than this. This is the kind of specification a designer is given. So now the designer is given output capacitance and input capacitance. These are fixed values. These he cannot change, and this is a fixed value. So this is now a constant. So there you have a scenario where you want to minimize the sum of terms, where the product of terms is constant. And there is a theorem in maths which says that this happens when all the terms are equal. Okay, so if all the terms are equal, then d1 should be equal to dk and should be equal to dn, isn't it? And then you and you can also find the value of each of the terms. So you call the product of all the g's as capital G, that is product of all stage logical efforts is path logical effort. I'll discuss that. This is called logical effort, and product of all C out by C ins is also a fixed value. It is C out by C in 1. This H is just C in K plus 1 by C in K. HK is C in K plus 1 by C in K. C out by C in of each stage is called H. Okay. So product of all H, which is capital H, is a fixed value. It is C out by C in 1. And this is G. So what is the, if I want to write G into H of each stage as F, what is the value of F? It is capital G into capital H to the power 1 by N, where N are the number of stages. Isn't it? When you keep each of the F equal to G capital G into capital H to the power 1 by N, then you get minimum delay for a given N. Okay, so how do you manage this? So you start from C out. You know the N. Suppose you know the N. Okay, this is my logic circuit, and these are all logic gates involved there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There are 6 logic gates. I know my 6, isn't it? What is the value? So it's now C out divided by. So what I'll do? I'll multiply all G's. I'll multiply C out by required C in. Required C out by specification C in, and then I'll take it to the power 1 by 6. Okay, 6 logic gates were there in series, so 1 by 6 I'll do, and then I'll get the value of F. That F is equal to G into H. So for example, the last stage was suppose an AND gate. G is 4 by 3. So I get C out divided by C in is equal to whatever F I had got divided by 4 by 3, isn't it? So C in of this gate, so C out divided by C, so what is the C in of this gate? That I can get now, the value of that, isn't it? And C in of this gate will give me the size of this gate. So I have sized the first stage. Likewise, I size all the stages, okay? Okay, so here we'll discuss this further. Suppose you have this logic circuit. Now I have input capacitance C and 4.5 C here. Now it's very difficult to know whether for 3 stages I can size them, but is this 3 ideal value? See, if I now the delay, how can I write? Delay I can write as, how can I write the delay? Delay is equal to G into H. So, okay, I'll just do that. Total delay is now D1 plus D2 plus Dn, which is G1 H1 plus Gn Hn plus sum of all parasitic delays, but we know all of them are equal, isn't it? So it is n times f, small f, which we have defined as small f is g into h of each stage, so plus sum of parasitic delays, isn't? And what is this small f? Small f is n times g into h to the power 1 by n plus parasitic delays, isn't? This is called, let us give it a name f, total effort. This is called total logical effort, total electrical effort, total effort f. So I have an expression that total delay is now looking like, total delay d of the path is looking like n into f to the power 1 by n plus p. Now when I increase, suppose I add two inverters here, I have increased n, does the delay increase or reduce? I don't know, because f to the power 1 by n is reducing, but multiplication with n is increasing it. So I don't know, there is an optimization, small optimization problem here, isn't it? So how do I resolve this problem? So I would just take a derivative of this and I would equate it to 0. If you want, I'll derive this later. But okay, there is only one small thing here. If you use this, f to the power 1 by n is equal to e to the power if you use this identity, you can derive this. Isn't? So from this equating it to 0, you get an expression of the form, you get this expression if you use that identity, which I have written there. Okay? If you use this identity in this equation, you get this expression. Once you get this expression, you can write it in this manner, isn't it? This looks like some P inverter, plus, if I call this as rho into 1 minus natural logarithm of rho is equal to 0. This I am calling rho. Okay, and this n would give me the minimum delay. See, till now, initially what we were doing, we were fixing n. Now I am saying that changing n also can reduce delay. That is, increasing n also can reduce delay. I don't know. So if I want to increase delay n, what would I do? Without changing the logic, I'll add inverters at the end. If I add inverters at the end, I don't change the logic. I may invert it, but I don't change the logic essentially. But I will just keep on adding inverters. If I add two inverters, I don't change logic at all. I don't even invert it, isn't? So I want to find the ideal n, so that if this is my logic block with fixed value of n, I want to add inverters. I add inverters in such a way that my entire delay actually now becomes minimum. Okay, so how would I do this? I would try take this equation, find out the value of rho. So when I fit this equation empirically I find that this becomes minimum for a value of rho like this, some dependent on p inverter. Okay, because I am adding p inverters only here. Rest of all the logic gates are fixed logic gates, they cannot be changed because that will change the logic. Okay. So now, so if I know rho, then what is the ideal, ideal n, what is the ideal n? If I find out this ideal f to the power 1 by n this way, this rho is f to the power 1 by n, isn't it? This is f to the power 1 by n. If I find ideal f to the power 1 by n using this empirical expression, how can I find n? It is just log f divided by log ideal f to the power 1 by n. Okay, that gives me ideal number of stages. So I can add as many inverters here. See, why is this method so good? It is good because it's not dependent on the current expression. And with scaling, changing devices, etc., you keep on changing the expression of current. The earlier relationships were all based on the current expression. So now we have a method of sizing the transistors without thinking about the expression of current, isn't it? It's very generic and very powerful that way. So now if I plot, there is one question that might arise in the minds of everyone, that if this n comes out to be a non-integer, what to do? Now I cannot have a number of half a logic gate sitting there. It's not just impossible. So what would I do? Then I find that this delay, if I plot delay with non-ideal n and delay with ideal n, n cap is ideal n, then I find that with n divided by n cap increasing this way, the delay minimizes at this point, okay, where n by n cap is 1, obvious, and then it increases this way. I find that if I increase the number of stages by 1, I don't add much to delay. If I reduce, I add more to delay. Okay. So if I get, say, ideal n from my expression to be 3.2, then I'll use 4 stages. If I get 5.2, there are, say, 4 essential logic gates and 1 inverter that I can add. 5.2 means I'll make it 6. I'll add 2 inverters instead of. Okay. So that's the way we. Because here I find that when I increase the number of stages, the increase in delay is not much, isn't it? So that is how one uses this method of logical effort. So you can do these kind of example problems. This is a decoder, isn't it? Output capacitance is, say, 9.6 times some unit, and input capacitance is supposed to be 10 units, then it is 9.6 is Cout by Cin. So just resolve the problem and add as many number of stages as needed when you solve the problem. Okay, so for this, you just need to know the G of this is known, 4 by 3. Take the parasitic delay to be 1 for your calculation sake and just do this example. You'll get how to do this. So why are these timing issues? I'll just start. Or do I have time now? Or
I think maybe in 1 or 2 minutes you can conclude and then we can call the question.
Okay, because I have not started the other part. I have done the initial tutorial part of the thing, but it's okay.
Yeah.
Okay, but okay. Why do these timing issues become so important in VLSI circuits these days? We see that gate oxide thickness, channel doping, source drain depth and source drain doping density have reached their almost final kind of values. You cannot change them much now. So the technology scaling is now encountering a big issue that you just can't scale the planar devices now. So that's why multi-gate devices, etc., FinFETs, etc., are now coming up, isn't it? But planar devices will also not go away. They will also remain. So how to make them remain? So one of the methods that people are resorting to is introducing mechanical stress into the channel of devices in certain manner. So when you stress the, I'll not go into the physics of that right now because I think there's no time. I'll just introduce. So how do you introduce stress to this device? So this is a MOSFET cross section that you can see. So here, you instead of using silicon source and drain, use silicon germanium source and drain. Germanium is a larger atom. So if this source and drain will stress the channel, compressive. Okay. Likewise, have some layer over this compressive stress layer. That will again give a compressive stress to the channel. So compressive stress in the source drain direction for a P MOSFET is useful. That increases the mobility of P device of holes. Why? That is there in the slides, but I'll not explain now because there is no time. The other part is, for example, for an N MOSFET, you do a tensile stress along the channel direction, increases the electron mobility. So how do you manage again? People are working on using silicon carbide source and drain, because carbon has a smaller lattice, and the carbon atom is smaller than silicon, but it has the same number of valence electrons, isn't it? So once you integrate that, it will give you tensile stress in the channel, and use a layer over and above the device also, which again gives you tensile stress, isn't it? So that would
that would increase electron mobility. But once you do this, there are issues in circuits. This is a layout of a NMOSFET. Have you seen layouts? So if this is layout of an NMOSFET. Now, if when you increase the distance between these two, that is pitch between these two gates. These two are 1, 2, 3 are gates, right? And this is diffusion. When you increase the distance between them, suppose you have integrated silicon germanium into the you have a silicon germanium source drain, then this diffusion is actually silicon germanium. The volume of silicon germanium has changed. Because of that, channel stress now changes. So channel stress is now highly dependent on layout parameters. Okay. So what we have done in our group is that getting the logical effort values by changing the layout. I mean, when layout changes, how does the logical effort change for inverters and for NAND gates? Suppose for inverters and NAND gates, we have right now handled. The problem is more complex. So if you take other logic gates, it would become even more complex. But can you estimate these logical effort values as the layout changes? So see, earlier when the logic gate changed, logical effort changed. But now when you change the layout itself, the channel stress is changing, the current is changing without even changing the size of the transistor. So can you account for these changes in layout? How do they translate to changes in logical effort? Okay, so that's what we have done. These are these lines are our the functions that we have derived. The points are TCAD simulation values. So I'll not go into this right now because we don't have time. But I think the method of logical effort is something which is which is not very well covered in textbooks even now. But it is a standard method. Popular method, which has been, which is quite popular in industry for past 10 years. Right. Okay. Okay. So now let us take queries because I think time is over.
Yes.
Sorry for the lecture was going so interesting, but because of the limitation of time, we have to start our valediction also at 3. So our expert has to wind up his lecture within this time limit. Now queries are welcome from all the networks. If you have any query, please go ahead with your query part. Yes. Any query from any one of our nodal centers?
Oh. Good afternoon, sir. Am I audible to you?
Yes. You want to ask something?
Yes, sir. I have a question
from SIT.
SMIT Borampur.
SMIT Borampur, sir.
Yes, you want to ask something?
Yes, sir. Is a delay model is there, many kind of, from RCM model and FMOS delay model, which will be fitted best?
Sorry, please repeat your question. Actually, your voice was not clear.
Sir, there are so many delay models, like RC delay model, Elmore's delay model, which will be preferred more, better?
Whose will be?
Preferred better, sir.
Yeah.
When you use Elmore delay model, you implicitly assume a transistor's equivalent circuit. So when you use Elmore delay model, for example, if you have a, I think I kept the rest. So you will try to look at the, for example, if you use Elmore delay model for an NAND gate, you will try to look at the output would be this is R1 for the first gate, second gate, isn't it? This is how you would look at the NAND gate, isn't it? NAND gate discharging path. This is how you would look at the Elmore delay model. So this is Elmore equivalent. So now what is the value of R that you want to fix for the transistor? It's one thing is it is changeable. The other thing is that once you fix it, it is as you change technology, it's not general anymore. What and can you actually replace a transistor by a RC, lumped RC? That's a very tough task to do, isn't it? I think doing that again adds to lot of approximations, and it works only for a certain technology. As you scale down, again it will not work. Again, you'll have to think about R and C, or whether to go for a more complex equivalent circuit. You'll have to think about all those things. With this method of logical effort, you don't need to think about all this.
So, any other query from any other center? I think one participant, I think, yes.
Anybody else?
Sir, yes, yes, please go ahead with your query.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay. So I think there is no query from our nodal centers right now. So just I thank Dr. Bulushu for his excellent talk on.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Hello, sir. I want to ask something.
Yeah, yeah. Please go ahead.
Sir, I'm speaking Pankaj from SIT Meerut.
SID Merit. Okay, please go ahead with your question.
Sir, I want to ask what is MFGS and what is working?
Okay, okay. MFGS is a multi-fingered gate structure. So, I could not go into that part of the talk because then I would have had to keep a long talk. So, this is an inverter layout. This is NMOSFET, PMOSFET. Now, all these fingers are parallel, isn't it? All these. So the whatever is the width of this PMOSFET into 4 is the actual width of that PMOSFET in the inverter, isn't it? So this is a multi-fingered gate structure, and in standard cells, all the gates are most of the gates, most means almost all of the gates are, or all the standard cells are multi-fingered gate structures. Now you don't find that is, you cannot increase the size of the standard cell by increasing the width of each of the fingers. There is a fixed limit beyond which you cannot increase the width of a finger in a standard cell library. I think I have answered your question.
Thank you, sir.
If you have further queries, I mean, if I have not answered what you were asking, you please ask again.
So I think yeah, we can just have break of 15 minutes here. So we will be here right at 3 p.m. So we are going to start our valedictory session at 3. So I request all the nodal centers to be there at 3, and our valedictory session will start from 3 and it will go up to 4. So thanks a lot, and please have a break of 15 minutes, and we'll be back. Thank you.